This is the story about a journey of 30 students who had never met each other before. We went on this journey to Poland in order to discover the truths about the horrific Holocaust. I was one of the students who went through this journey and would like to share my point of view with you. On the first day, we landed in Warsaw and got on a bus to the new Jewish cemetery.
We want to explore the Jews of Warsaw from before the war. We come to the cemetery, which is basically the home or the house of the living. It's exactly in a contradiction to what we think.
Even though it was called the New Jewish Cemetery, it sure didn't look like it.
What we saw as we were walking through, only when you got to the end did you see that that was the cared for part. That behind it was the actual history of the Jewish people here, and it was just overgrown, as if it was forgotten.
The message I got is that Earth and the world couldn't protect you back then, so today beauty and overgrowing nature is trying to revive the flame of your memories.
Then it hit us. The reason that it's neglected this much is because there's no one left to take care of it.
My family's also from this area, and I don't know anything about them. I don't know what stories they had, like many of their names, the songs they shared. It just shocked me that I walk around and I feel disconnected. I feel like I don't have a connection to these graves.
What we saw, people had a name, people had the symbols, like showed about the person, what they did with their lives. And then as you walk and you get to the mass grave, you see it doesn't matter what you did, it doesn't matter what you built, the name that you built for yourself, what you contribute to society, it meant absolutely nothing, because at the end of the day, you're a Jew. You don't deserve a tombstone, you're in a mass grave with everyone else.
Something I really got from being there is that the significance of what the Holocaust was, which is that I think it was much more than about killing people. It was really about erasing people. There's a reason they were doing mass graves, and there's a reason that they were taking away people's names and giving them numbers. And I feel like just by going there, you're trying to give people back their respect that they deserved as human beings.
The second day took place in Krakow. We were in the Kazimierz district, where we visited both a cemetery and a synagogue. At the synagogue, some of us put on tefillin and said the Shema for the first time since our bar mitzvah. At the grave of Rabbi Moses Isalish, we wrote down notes with different wishes we hope to come true. Later that day, we were at the Krakow ghetto, the only one whose border remained standing after the war. That was the first time where we saw proof. This really happened. It's not just a story to tell. The last place we visited that evening took everyone by surprise. We were standing on grass, solely grass, with nothing else around us.
We, the people who are standing here in this ceremony, are succeeding each and every day on at least one task: listening and accepting each other. Freedom of speech on a daily basis is part of our success in realizing our responsibility. Accepting the other, regardless on their race, religion, or gender, is the realization of our responsibility. Our greater accomplishment is seeing the person standing in front of us in the same way he wishes to see himself.
This was the Plush of concentration camp that was erased from the earth by Nazi Germany in order to hide any evidence of the murder. On day 3, we visited one of the more famous camps, Auschwitz and Birkenau. The items put on display further proved the existence of the Holocaust and affected each and every one of us in different ways.
When we walked into the suitcase room, as I showed you guys today, I had a picture of my grandmother's uncle's suitcase in there. I was thrilled, angry, happy, and obviously I very much wanted just to see the suitcase, to get something tangible out of it, to make it real.
What really paints the picture is the stories, and that brings it down into reality and helps you feel kind of, at least what I expected to feel, which was humanity, like people trying to survive. And I think the first thing that got me into that was seeing the hair. That was like disturbing. I don't think I've ever felt my whole like goosebumps all the way up and down. I could barely look at it. I had to tell myself to go back into the room because I left initially.
As soon as I stepped in that room, I was disgusted. I couldn't, I looked in there for less than a second. I had to turn away. I couldn't, and that was, it was hard.
For me, the hardest part was seeing the pictures from the children. I was a nanny in America, and I'm still nannying for the same family. And I brought a picture that the girl drew for me, and walking throughout there, all I could picture was that picture. It was just very overwhelming.
It was very difficult. Imagine that maybe one of those kids would be like my nephew.
You walk around and you say, okay, like, it's not a museum, it's not a replica, it's the actual thing. People were standing on this ground where I am, people were in these barracks, but I don't know how to put myself in the mindset of like realizing that people were killed here and people were suffering here. But I think the closest I'm getting to realizing that it's real is taking some stories and trying to make them more personal.
Well, I'm going to tell you the story of Eliza Bau. She was born in 1928 from Thessaloniki, which is in Greece. She was sent to Block 10, this block right here. She passed 3 sets of radiation treatments, which is incredible. Which had immediate effects on her, such as nausea, vomit, and within 24 hours after the experiments, she had no body hair whatsoever. She had no hair up here, no body hair, she had nothing. One day, Dr. Schmuel, who worked under Dr. Joseph Mengele, he took over because Joseph Mengele had to leave. And of course, he was Jewish. He was a gynecologist, and he had conducted a surgery on her. He came in to check up on her, and when he removed her bandage, she woke up and saw that she had 35 stitches. She started yelling at him. She said, "You're one of us, you're Jewish. How could you do this to us? Like, who are you? Why did you do this to me?" And he tried to calm her down. He said, "Eliza, be strong. One day you'll thank me." When she arrived in Israel, her stomach, she had a lot of stomach pains, and when she got to Belinson, the hospital in Israel, they told her that she was pregnant, and she said it couldn't be. She told them the story that happened in Auschwitz. He said, "He took both of my ovaries out." And then she remembered what the doctor Shmuel said. He said, "Don't worry, one day you'll thank me." So what he actually did was he only took one ovary out, and he basically saved her. So she ended up having a kid, and then in total 4 kids.
There's so many stories that we won't be able to touch, but at least we can try our best to get at least a bigger picture and at least focus on as many little stories as we can to give the respect that we could to those people at least.
But what really got me was the wall that they'd be taken to be shot, yeah. And I turned around when everybody was facing that to see like what their last like picture would be of this world. And it was just, I mean, there was a lot of things. It was just hard going through and picturing like what these people, where they found their hope.
I was genuinely very afraid to walk into Auschwitz today. because unfortunately I've never had the pleasure of meeting my grandmother. It was a very hard day for me, because the unknown was extremely difficult for me to imagine. So.
My whole life I didn't understand why my grandfather never was never happy. His whole family, cousins, everything, everyone died, and he and his two parents just survived. After I was like checking the names of all his family members, I could understand why. He's never been basically happy in his whole life. So looking forward to talking to him and sharing this with him.
I know I will be back here, and I'll be so proud to wear that flag again that I wore to Auschwitz. With my kids and be able to explain to them the value of their identity.
Until we were sitting in the barracks talking about the top bunk, the hats, you know, why you choose this and the fights, I had this picture of the Jewish people in the camps banded together, but it was really everyone for themselves and against each other. And then at the same time, like if you're alone and you come from Hungary or Poland or Paris, you don't speak the same language. You can't even express the depression and the need to like have another human to talk to, because you don't even speak the same language. And it's just that it's like suffering is one universal language.
Having all the other groups walk around and look at us, I really was, you know, just so proud to walk around there and be like, we're an Israeli delegation, we're coming from Israel and we can. And especially when we sat outside of Birkenau and people were walking past taking photos. I imagine what they were thinking, and I imagine them being from every country in the world or wherever they're from, and they're like, wow, Israelis are coming to see where their people and many others were killed. And that was just, that pride was something really unimaginable.
My darling, on this, the last night of my life, I bid you farewell. Our days of happiness were short-lived but beautiful. At this moment, I am remembering our love from its beautiful beginning until its cruel end. You were the love of my life, and I would willingly have sacrificed everything to save you. And our innocent little Otto, why has it been decreed that this rough, ruthless hand should put an end to his short life?
The letter that you read, I all of a sudden felt the sense of doom that this person understood finally. It was just really hard to imagine that dying happened millions of times in that place where we were standing today, where you understand that it's the end of your life.
And you don't get to say goodbye.
My darling, thank you with all of my heart for your devotion, your love, and for your happiness, and for the happiness you have given me. Stay the way you are today, a dauntless hero who never gives in. I will think of you and pray for your rescue until my last breath. Lastly, please send my best wishes to all of your friends. Farewell, love of my life. Ellie and your little Otto, send your kisses for the last time. Goodbye, Auschwitz-Birkenau.
My dad's favorite song is Hallelujah, and when I heard that today, sitting in the same place that so many people would have just marched into gas chambers, it was the first time that I had thought about my own family in that situation. Just the picture of my dad with that song like was so emotional for me that it brought a whole other level of meaning to it.
At the end of the ceremony, we all took 10 minutes to ourselves and walked around in the darkness, wondering how they survived this kind of living, if you can call it that. The next morning was cold. We were at Kielce, which unfortunately is very well known for the horrifying story of the children's massacre.
May 23rd, all the kids, 45 in number, all taken to here. grabbed from the parents, separated from the parents, and murdered. As you can see, this is the mass grave and the memorial for those 45 kids. Hashem Yikom Damam.
I want to light this candle in memory of Simon Wiesenthal, a survivor and a hero that brought some justice to the world by avenging the blood of the Jews that were slaughtered and dedicated his life to hunting.
I want to light this candle in honor of my family. I'm lighting this candle in honor of my mom's great aunt.
I'm lighting this candle in memory of Maurice Cohn.
My dad's side, the Harriman family, Sigmund, Ida, Selma, Irma, and Ernst.
I'm lighting this candle in memoriam of my grandmother's family and my grandfather's family.
I'm lighting this candle in honor of my grandma's brother.
Also lighting this candle in honor of my grandparents who were born in Romania and had their own Holocaust. And especially lighting this candle in honor of my grandfather, who passed away this summer, who was also born in Romania and suffered throughout the time of the Holocaust.
I want to light this candle on behalf of one of my family members. His name is Lizer Rakovich.
I'm going to dedicate this candle to my grandmother, Chaya Vogelstein, and her sister, Franza Vogelstein.
I want to light the candle for Hannah Rosterstachen. She's the aunt of my grandmother.
I want to dedicate this candle to my grandfather's family from Saloniki, who most of them were deported to Auschwitz and perished there, as well as my grandmother's family, who's from Lodz.
In honor of my grandmother's family, who perished in Treblinka, and the two women who were responsible for saving my grandmother's life, as well as my grandmother, her two parents, Chaim Zilber and Lazra Zilber, her siblings, Nutek Zilber, Moniek Zilber, Ichek Zilber, Penina Siegel, Lucia Siegel, Sasha Zilber.
I want to light this candle on behalf of my friend and in honor of his family, the Holocaust survivor.
I'm going to light this candle for my grand-grandmother family, her uncle and aunt.
Chucho said, I want to light a candle for your relatives, that completely broke me, because like that's just, to see someone who has no, I don't want to say no connection, but no historical, no blood connection to the Holocaust, and just to be standing next to me in the cold, and to even know to say that, it's something that I wasn't expecting him or anyone else to say, and the when you said it, it was just beautiful and unbelievable, and I thank you for it, I'm sure everyone thanks you for it.
During the ceremony in Majdanek, the Mound of Ashes reminded us of how hard it must have been to be a Jew in Europe back then. Today, we have the privilege of being united in Poland and not have to hide our identity anymore. At the Yeshiva in Lublin, we proudly danced and sang songs in Hebrew. On Friday, we visited the Warsaw Ghetto.
So this is the very, very south end or beginning of the ghetto. From here, it goes basically north. And as I said, to the other side is 4 kilometers. Wide is 1 kilometer. So we're now walking along the Warsaw Ghetto walls
on a street named Zhelezhna. When we talk about how people lived in the ghetto, here you have the opportunity to really see the blocks where, how people live in the ghetto. You can see it's like there is a main courtyard. Relatively, I mean, what is it, like 5 stories? It can be 6 stories buildings. Many, many apartments. Back then, it's not like 5 members of a family in each one of those apartments. As you said before, many, many more. There was a guy named Emanuel Ringenblum, a well-known Polish Jewish historian who was actually teaching in the University of Warsaw. And he was Jewish, so he was actually moved to the ghetto with the rest of the Jews. But he was among the first ones to realize that maybe this time is different. This is the time to actually document and put down experiences and memories. He collected all of those memories and experiences of people, the day-to-day life, and he actually kept it. People realized that it doesn't matter what they do, whether they stay quiet or resist, eventually they'll die. That's the only time, you know, 50,000 people who stayed in the ghetto realized that, you know, let's fight at least and die, you know, in an act of heroism.
After hearing the story of these brave warriors, we made our way to the bunker of Mile 18, which was the perfect place to hear more about the ghetto fighters' uprising. On top of where the bunker used to be, there was a certain story we had to hear.
It was commanded by a 23-year-old man named Mordechai Anilevich. The day of the outbreaking of this uprising was... It was April 19th of 1943. But it was also Nisan. It was a Passover evening.
The fact that we can proudly tell this story and to have the opportunity to celebrate many Passover Seders was his victory. Every year we celebrate a Seder, and the Warsaw Ghetto Seder was not the last one.
Stand here today with you, a second generation Israeli, descendant of 4 former European families from Lithuania, Russia, and Ukraine. Most of them immigrated to Palestine in the 1920s and 1930s to start and take part in the creation of a Jewish state. Some stayed behind and were assassinated by their neighbors and Nazi soldiers in early of 1941. This week allows us to share experiences, thoughts, and dilemmas, to learn about, to witness firsthand the past, both the life and history of the Jewish people before, and of course about the unbearable circumstances it all terminated during and after the Second World War. I stand here today proud and thankful for taking part in this unique and unforgettable journey. Honoring the past, but more important, equipped to shape a better future.
We have the ability to make history for the future. So we're the ones who are responsible to shape the future. We are the ones who can prevent those bad things from happening.
On Saturday, we were lucky enough to hear the story of Władysław Ostichko, a righteous among the nations. Władysław heroically took a risk by hiding his Jewish neighbor throughout a period of the Holocaust. If the Germans found out what he was doing, both him and his neighbor would have instantly been murdered.
I cała przyjemność też po mojej stronie. Ja z przyjemnością, opowiadając młodzieży właśnie takiej jak wy, wiem, że to nie zostanie, że tak powiem, bez echa. I na pewno przekażecie swoim znajomym, swoim rodzinom, prawda, to, co ewentualnie nowego tu powiedziałem.
Władi, we will never forget your story and are honored to have met you. Apart from Auschwitz, Treblinka was the camp that exterminated the most Jews, 870,000 in number. The camp was one of the three Reinhardt operations, which were the first three death camps result of the Wannsee Conference. Most Jews were transferred to Treblinka from the Warsaw Ghetto, about 300,000. While most labor camps were able to be seen, these death camps were hidden.
It's a great autumn morning. People were stuffed in the cattle car, and they kept asking again and again if I could see any station, any train station around. The cattle car shaked when it moved from one track to another. The train started to slow down. We got into a train station.
We walked to the Treblinka Memorial, which consists of 17,000 stones that represent the communities who perished in the Holocaust.
For different reasons, the date of the uprising was changed several times. Many transports from the Warsaw Ghetto arrived in Treblinka, and from the Jews we learned about the uprising in the Warsaw Ghetto. The last deportees from the Warsaw Ghetto armed themselves with grenades and explosive materials. It is night. The fight has already lasted 6 hours. The Germans have received help and our numbers are fewer and fewer. There is a lack of ammunition. Our duty is done. We destroyed the camp and the murderers are dead. We killed 200 Germans and Ukrainian fascists. We received the order to escape to the forest. Most of the fighters were killed. Many Germans were also killed. From among us, only a few survived.
I think we left the death factory on the afternoon of Wednesday, September 9th. I had been there for 17 days, each of which was more like a century. It would be more appropriate to reckon the time I spent in this inferno in seconds, not days.
Survivor Eddie Weinstein on being liberated by Russian soldiers. It was about 2 o'clock on Monday afternoon, July the 31st, 1944. I will always consider this date as meaningful as the day of my birth. Father felt the same way. When people asked him how old he was, he used to say he was born on July the 31st, 1944.
Jews from East Poland never experienced the Holocaust because they were under Soviet control. That was until the Nazis took over in 1941. During the morning of August 25th, the Germans ordered all the Tykocin Jews to gather at the market square to be resettled in a ghetto. Little did they know, they were marching to their death.
Listen to the last cry of the murdered over these pits of horror. Listen to their eternal testament in the promise we shall not forget. Halina Birnbaum.
Here's a Jew who's hanging by a hair. He's fighting with sadness against desperation, which is eating away at him like a worm. Joy has left me as has knowledge. Voices from the past whisper from me to stop, but I continue to dig in the darkness and ask and request, where are you?
I'll be reading a quote from De Frankel. We who live in concentration camps can remember the men who walked through the huts, comforting others, giving away the last piece of bread. They may have been few in number, but they offer sufficient proof that everything can be taken from man but one thing, the last of the human freedoms, to choose one's attitude in any given set of circumstances, to choose one's own way.
תלמד יברך קורתי, ואלמיך מלכותי, ויתמח פורקנה, ויקרב משיחה, וחי אכול ומאכול, וחיי ככל בית ישראל, בעגלה ובזמן קריב וירוע מן, עושה שלום במרומם, הוא יעשה שלום עלינו, ועל כל עמו ישראל וירוע מן.
I felt very, I don't want to say happy this trip, but very happy to be here and to be, you know, like, this is what I came out of it, like, I win, you know? And I was very mad about it at first. I was like, how could I be happy to be here? You know, everyone's so emotional and like, I just can't be. And like, I don't cry very often, but this is something I've learned about my whole life. And I've always dreamt about just coming to Poland and like understanding it. And just what I pictured myself, yeah, I pictured myself just bawling on the floor, like actually with so many emotions.
Well, first, I'm like a strong person, as you guys may know. I don't like to show weakness. I'm terrified of it. I hate it. I hate crying. I hate showing people that I cry. I need to be like a tough wall. And within this group, I feel completely comfortable crying. And there are people who I could, like looking around in the beginning, could have never expected to even have the ability to cry or anything. I saw them cry and I just really feel like comfortable. Showing a little bit of weakness in this group, so just thank you.
Even though everyone was like crying, I was too afraid to also cry. So then I wasn't really focused as much as I should have been this whole trip. I didn't really listen as much as I should have. And I said every day, I don't want to come back here, I don't want to come back here, like every single day. But I'm starting to think that like, maybe I want to go back home and like study about it and like learn about it and then try to understand it and then come back again and it'll be like completely different.
I didn't really know a lot about it because like my grandparents never really told me. Like I knew that they were survivors and like my grandma had a horrible story and stuff.
I wanted to understand the roots of where it all started, pretty much.
My partner's grandfather, his name is Alexander Nathaniel Levy. He comes from Iași, Romania. He arrived at Auschwitz with his wife and two daughters that were sent immediately to gas. Basically, what we know is that he was chosen to be a Sonderkommando. He didn't really have a choice. There were riots, and they decided to bomb the crematorium. And after they bombed it, basically all the Sonderkommando started escaping to the fields behind them. The Nazis shot them. He was shot in the head, so he just dropped. And they thought he was dead. And during the night, the partisan came, and they saw that he's still breathing, and they saved him.
All of you here, you had stories and everything to tell that was related to you and your relatives, and that was really powerful. And I was really happy that I got to be in this group and hear all those stories.
We have to always be there for each other no matter what. Even if we don't have to write our name on the thing or make a post or write this or do this, without even taking credit, just give someone a hand or a shoulder to cry on, to lean on, to understand.
All of you are one of the biggest factors that made my experience what it was, and I don't think it would have even been close to what it was without each and every one of you. Every person brought a different dynamic to this trip.
You guys really made this trip amazing, incredible, nothing like I'll ever experience again in my life. I wouldn't trade it for anything else in the world, and it was fantastic. Thank you.
I've never experienced anything like this. I've never seen like 30 plus 30 people being like feeling so connected and like feeling each other and I don't know, like feeling each other's stories. And you know, this is something I just want to say like a huge thank you for you guys. Like if anything, like this is like one of the biggest accomplishments like I got in this trip, in this journey.
All those people who keep saying, you know, not connected, or they feel disconnected for the reason being that they're maybe not Jewish or not, don't come from, they don't have Ashkenazi, you know, roots or whatever the case, or they do but they don't feel connected. Those grandparents weren't in the Holocaust. I wanted to say that, like, thank you for coming on this trip, because for me it was just enlightening and it made it even more meaningful. And
seeing everyone, all of you guys sitting in the crowd, I was standing up above, like I got to watch, which was really emotional also.
and seeing Chucho with his kippa on.
Specific memory that I'm taking is when, I don't know if you all saw it, it was this old couple that came and joined the ceremony and stood with us, and from the point of view that I was standing, I could see the expressions on the old man. I have no idea what his story is and if he's related or anything, but I could see pain, I could see, it was amazing. And I don't know, it's something.
When we were standing at Mila 18, I don't know if it was the Carly Bach song that we listened to or what, but I really broke down. We talk about Judah the Maccabee on Hanukkah, and every year we commemorate that, but like, Mordechai Nilevich was a Maccabee, I really think. Why do we fast on a day that a rabbi died, you know, 1,000 years ago, but we don't fast for 6 million Jews?
A letter from the living. I'm sorry you died and I live. I wish I could justify this in any way except for clinging greedily and pathetically to my own life and my own aspirations, when in truth you deserve these things as much as I did. I live by the grace of your suffering, and nothing I do until the end of time itself will bring you justice. You are the hallowed and the noble. Once you looked at the gates from the inside and wondered why it was you who would have to die, I look at them from the outside and wonder why I deserve to live. I wish that for a second I could taste your bitterness and you could have my joy, that I could know what it feels like to be doomed, and you would know what it feels like to have more than any human being possibly has a right to. I wish you were buried in a grave and not in a mountain of ashes. I wish that you had a family to remember you, and not a stranger who sees ashes on the ground and wonders who they belong to. The truth is, you deserve so much more than this, what this merciless world gave you. The lives men live are long and confused, but I will never mistake my good fortune for justice. Maybe in the next life the monsters are the victims and the wronged are the redeemed. Maybe in the next life you stand by a pile of ashes and wonder why you deserve to live. I tell myself that I've honored you, but the truth is that I flatter myself.
Every single person has to come, and it's not because of, like, is he Jewish, not Jewish. I don't think this story is about that, it's that much about Judaism or Jewish people. I think it's about people being killed for no reason.
It gave me a better appreciation for what these people were going through, because this was just me thinking about it for a week, and it was already wearing me down. And they actually had to live it for months and even years.
When my parents, my mom, or my aunts, they passed by, if there were kids, the kids were told to go inside the house because they're witches, they're Jews. Nobody should be around them. So I didn't experience that. And when I came to Israel, like, it's a Jewish state, you're very welcome, Jew, like being a Jew. But this trip made me understand like what anti-Semitism really is. It was just like, the only time that I feel safe is in Israel now. I'm sorry, but it is.
And this past week was so like revealing to me how proud I am to be Jewish, and how proud I am to have this kind of history, and how much stronger it made the people that I'm related to, and it made me so, so proud.
But with the fires going on in Israel while we're here, it gave me another slap in the face that we say never forget, and that it's very different now, but at the same time, there's still people coming at us just because we're Jewish.
The fact that we can proudly sing Hatikva, a song of hope for a Jewish state and nation, on a land that used to be so anti-Semitic and on a land where so many of our people were murdered, should not be taken for granted. It was an honor to have experienced this journey to Poland, which will have an effect on us for as long as we live. The things we saw, the things we learned, and the people we experienced it with will never be forgotten. Although this is the end of the movie, this is only the beginning of our journey.